So from that absorbing medal race in the 49ers, we switch our attentions now to the 49er FX, the women's version of the same boat. We'll talk details and technical shortly, but a big wave from the thousands that have turned out to the dockside here. The brand new International Sailing Centre in Aarhus, opened in May and providing a fabulous backdrop for these World Championships here in Denmark. So this is how they go into the 49er FX medal race. And like the men before them, the leaders have a big lead over second place. Tanja Frank and Lorena Abicht of Austria have 11 points over Wegelin and Ainsworth of Great Britain. And it's only 3 points further back to third place, Beckering and Duetsch of the Netherlands. So the top four could win gold, the top five can win silver, and the top six could win bronze. Pretty close. And we're looking out across the course. Those are the leaders, the two women to catch, Tanja Frank and Lorena Abicht, with about 7 minutes to go to the start of this race. And they'll be setting up, looking at the course, seeing how the wind has changed. We were expecting a storm to come through, weren't we, Jordan? But it doesn't seem to have materialised, thankfully. In fact, it's turned into a very nice afternoon in Aarhus.
Yeah, there was a forecast of a storm, but we've actually seen the wind just drop out the whole time that 49er race is on, and we were at 12 knots during that race and we're down to 6 at the moment, so it's quite interesting.
Let's hear from the women now, and before they set off, Matt Sheehan, as always, in the boat park with his microphone.
So, you're wearing the yellow bibs again, you're getting quite comfortable in those yellow bibs. Are you going to keep them by the end of the day?
Well, we hope so, but we already reached our goal with getting the national ticket, so we're quite relaxed on this.
Do you think that's probably quite a good way to go into a medal race, feeling a bit relaxed?
Yeah, I think so too. Well, I think as we know in a medal race, everything is possible, so, and sometimes like even it's unpredictable, so it's kind of, we will just do whatever we can do and everything what is possible for us, and I think cannot do more than this.
We're pretty excited. We're really proud of what we've done this event. Didn't start out particularly well for us, and we've just done our thing and kept going and plugging away. And it's fantastic to be going into the medal race in silver position. And whatever happens, we can be really proud of what we've done.
Yes, as you say, it's a really nice way to do. I mean, what was the turning point during the week that sort of saw you start to rise up the points table?
We haven't really changed that much. We've stuck to our processes quite a lot. Been very clear on our goals, what we're trying to achieve, and just supported each other through the event. It's been really fun.
Yeah, feeling good. Looks like a nice day on the water.
Changeable day on the water.
Very changeable. Yeah. Everything can happen, and we're in a great position for the races, so we're excited.
And what's your target? Because the top four boats can all reach gold.
Yeah, we're going for gold. We don't have everything under control, so we're just going to sail a nice race.
Sail your own race, or are you targeting someone?
Well, we have to sail our own race because we're with four boats, yeah. But if we have an opportunity, we'll take the opportunity. But we're going to go for the best.
Well, those are the plans. But looking out, the water seems to be getting lighter. We'll get an update from Jenny in a moment. But first, let's find out a little bit more about the 49er FX. The boat they've come out to watch. And a perfectly choreographed Aarhus wave. But the course is just in front of them. It's been set up nicely so that they can see the racing happen in front of their eyes. And it's also a perfectly placed grandstand for the sail past, which we get after every medal race when the winners parade their boats in front of the crowd. That's where they're racing. That's where we'll be heading off to shortly. We've got about 3.5 minutes to the start. And as you can see, pretty close to the shore, which does have an effect on wind conditions.
We need wind from there.
And that is the committee boat. Those are the race officials just checking the wind direction, making sure they've set up the course as fairly as is possible. So 3 minutes to the start of the FX Women's Medal Race. And you can see them just milling around, trying to make their last-minute preparations. And I wonder what conditions are like on the actual start line itself. Jordan, how's it looking?
Okay, so our top mark is set at 1 kilometre long. It's just over half a nautical mile. The wind is just, it's almost dead square to the wind. The port end of the line, the pin end of the line, has the 30-metre advantage. The line's 140 metres long. It looks like a good day to go sailing.
Olympic, world and continental champions are all in this race. The highest calibre of sailor and a real treat for the home crowd with two Danish pairs in the medal race. Also in the mix in this fleet are the Brazilians. The Brazilians who won gold in Rio, Grail and Kunsa. But these are the women that the crowds have come to cheer on. Bud Nielsen and Olsen, and the other pairing of Hansen and Salskov and Everson, the actual defending world champions. They're the ones that a lot of Danish hopes are pinned on right now. So what are they trying to do now, Evie?
Yeah, they're trying to look at the wind, I think. The wind is quite far in the left corner at the moment, almost 60-metre advantage on the pin end, which explains why most of them are really coming towards the left side of the line, so away from the committee boat, which we see right now. And, yeah, I think they will try to get a good start.
Seconds counting down. The boats being held back. They're there, they're poised, they're ready to go. It's not easy to do, is it, holding these machines back?
No, definitely. So they're a little bit behind the line, and then they all need to find out about the time and distance. So how long does it take to cross the starting line at the right moment of the start? And that's something that takes a lot of preparation, a lot of training, and it makes a huge difference in conditions like that. And as we speak, the wind just shifted to the right, and the line has almost no bias anymore now.
Well, we began the championship with 60 teams from 25 nations in the FX class. 27 races later, the top 10 here lining up to decide who will be world champion. So the question, can anyone reel in the Austrian leaders? And the Danes getting away in the middle of the fleet there at the centre of the line. And the wind's getting really light.
The wind is getting really light. The Brazilian team came in on port and rolled into attack to try and keep their speed up whilst everyone was sitting on the line. I was intrigued to see if that was going to pay off for them. It doesn't seem to have at the moment. Just looking down on the fleet a little bit there, the Austrian team, so maybe that wind is going to start bending left. I think if we get towards the pin end, you'll see most of the boats are starting to veer down. So it looks like the wind is bending left, and you can see at the top left of your shot, you can see the boats there are just pointing slightly lower. Or not as close to the wind as, say, the British team at this end. So it suggests that the wind is starting to veer as we go out. And I'd suggest
the Dutch of Beckering and Duetsch, who started third overall, are at the top of the screen at the far end of the line, heading off up to that left-hand side of the course. But just turning back in now.
Yeah, and the wind continues to shift further left. We're at 170 almost now.
Yeah. The Brazilian team, their little start manoeuvre didn't look like it worked for them, so they've actually had to split off and go out to the other side, so that hasn't worked very well for them. as you said, the four people can win this gold medal, so there's plenty of pressure on. And the Austrians have probably made the worst start of it. The wind is definitely down. Heavy. You can look at them. They're looking at everyone's transoms.
It's really is 5-6 knots, so it's going to be very, very tricky.
A nominal lead for Van Aanholt and Jongens of the Netherlands. But the breeze picking up a bit. Speed's increasing. The A-group sisters from Norway in the mix there, challenging near the front.
They're twins, I think.
They are.
Yeah.
And I think there's a little bit more pressure out on the right. From the analytics, we can see that the Austrian and Beckering and Duets are going a little bit faster, or actually are not faster than the rest. And I think that's giving them a climb up in the leaderboard at the moment.
So the Austrian team have managed, they're just hanging on, Evie, just going further and further across. So they're just hanging on. I guess they want to stay with the opposition.
Yeah, definitely. So they have an 11-point lead over the British, Wegelin and Ainsworth. So, yeah, there's still a top four that can win the gold. So you can never control four boats or three boats if you talk about the Austrians. But it's all about, you know, staying in the right tack and staying close to your opposition. And they are doing that at the moment. And at the moment, looking very much in control to hold on to that gold.
Our two girls, two women that did the Volvo Ocean Race have decided to both head right out to the right-hand side of the course. So the Danish superstar and the Brazilian superstar out on the right-hand side of the course. And Hansen and Grail.
We have gone through a period, and we see this often after Olympic Games, where sailors decide to take a break from their Olympic sailing and go off and try and do other things, or try new class of boats, try new partnerships. But now, 2 years out from Tokyo 2020, the focus is very much on those games, the partnerships coming together, and these World Championships, really the biggest test for all the sailors since the last Olympic Games. Let's get the latest from the course. Here's Jenny.
Well, earlier it was looking like beautiful conditions out here because the sun was out, but as you guys saw, the breeze is dying now, and I think it's because the very beginnings of this cold front are coming through. So while it might be sunny on the race course, just over the city of Aarhus, there are dark clouds. It looks like there's rain in front of us, and that's essentially killing the breeze that we have on the race course. So as you guys just said, the Volvo Ocean Racers are betting on the right-hand side. To me, it looks like possibly the darker part of this cloud line is on the right-hand side. So maybe that's what they're betting for, and they're hoping that with it comes breeze and a shift. But the angles are hugely different right now on the race course. You can see any bit of pressure, and boats can sail a lot faster and a lot higher, and otherwise they're sailing very deep looking for speed.
Real head-scratching time for the race officials as they try and work out what pattern of weather and wind we're going to get in the next few minutes. They desperately want to get this race finished.
I'd say it's more head-scratching time for the sailors. The race officials have got a fair race still going on at the moment, unless there's a massive thing. But as Jenny pointed out, she was talking about the clouds. The clouds are what's making the difference at the moment. So we've got clouds bring wind, and then they take it away once they go overhead. So that's exactly what's going on. And all the sailors will be reading the clouds. You can look around the course and see, and they'll be absolutely looking at those clouds as well as what's coming across the water to try and make that. And you can see there's just a dead patch right in the middle. You'd see that group in the middle were not moving. And on the corners, I think that was our Danish friends were having a little bit of fun out on the corners.
Now, consistency has been key to success over the last 10 days or so in Aarhus. Long qualifying campaign to get to this stage. And Frank and Abicht of Austria, well, they have sailed probably the most consistent series of all, which hardly anybody else in the fleet has been able to do in qualifying racing. Done in these sorts of difficult, shifty conditions, but also gusty conditions, all manner of different weather we've had. The Austrians were top 10 all the way, except for one finish of 25th.
Yeah, so what's going on the race course is that the wind is continuing to shift further and further to the left. So like already most of them were on the ley line or close to the left ley line, but have now actually are over the ley line. And that's why, you know, the Danish team of Hansen and Saskov Iversen, they were on the right side and they cannot get out of that corner because the wind's continuing to shift left. Yeah, very, very, very tricky racing here.
They're coming up to the first mark right now. You can see the orange boy, Frank and Abbott, are overall leaders, and now our race leaders. Gently does it up to the mark. And there's so little in it.
Yeah,
it's going to be difficult for the rest of the fleet to hunt these two down and take their gold medal from them in these conditions. But Dobson and Tidy, Maloney and Meech, the silver medalists in Rio from New Zealand, hot on their tail. Who's going to come in with the advantage to the mark? There are the Kiwis. Dobson and Tidy round in third. First of the two Dutch boats, Van Aanholt and Jongens, round the mark. There are the Brazilians. So Grail and Kunze sitting in fourth.
Yeah, it's looking really, really light at the moment. I think they are struggling to go around that top mark almost, because the pressure is, I think, down to 3-4 knots at the moment.
Yeah, it was interesting that wind moved so much left, and that last part of that beat, it was just really, really obvious. Just looking at the window, you could see how much of a move it was. And that made a hell of a difference in the
40
race.
40 degrees, actually.
Taking a long time to accelerate from that movement, from that manoeuvre. A long time from that manoeuvre. And what that means is that the leaders of the race will have had time to build up some distance between themselves and the rest of the fleet. And we'll get a measure of that in a moment. But Frank and Abbott still out in front.
Not only that, with a 40-degree movement, it makes one leg of the run, the long leg, and that's the starboard one at the moment. So most of these boats would be able to head almost straight into the bottom mark on starboard. So this is quite a risky manoeuvre we're seeing from the Danish team here, just starting to spin off to try and make a little bit of a gain. But they're only doing 5.8 knots at the front.
Let's have another look at that top mark rounding, because there was quite some congestion. And this is Denmark and Norway. And is there a touch?
Do you see the tiller extension on the leeward tiller extension on the Norway boat? I think just did actually touch that Denmark boat. Did you see that?
Or was
that
just hard to see, yeah, but it looked like they were struggling or something went wrong on the boat.
I wonder if Jenny managed to spot anything.
Saw was actually the Norwegians hit the mark on the way around. We're already trying to get out of the way to spin, and then the Danish came around behind them. So by the time the Danish were the leeward boat, I didn't actually see whether or not there was a hit, but the Norwegians were already spinning for their mark infringement.
So a penalty then for the Norwegians, and that will have dropped them down the fleet. But we're looking at the fleet making its way downwind now, with the Brazilians in fourth place and in the middle of these three boats. Hansen and Salskov Iversen closest to us.
It has been a majority starboard hand leg. The long leg is the starboard jibe. So what that means is the shortest distance to the mark. You're going to spend most of your time on starboard.
But look at the distance now between the bulk of the fleet and the two leaders. And Frank and Abbott wearing the golden bib of the overnight leaders going into the medal race, now pulling away from Maloney and Meech of New Zealand.
Just a little bit of pressure down at the bottom mark too. Probably a little bit more consistent, that pressure down there, probably around that seven and a half knots. certainly less as we get closer to the top mark, and it's still the same as we look up the course at the moment. This is a lovely place to be if you're leading a world championship with 11-point lead to come into the mark, bottom mark, well in front.
Yeah, definitely. They had a really good first upwind also. I think they were on the left side, but just hit that ley line perfectly, a little bit below. And, you know, they were taking into account that the wind might shift further to the left. And that was a great decision. And, also seemed to be very much in control here on the downwind.
And you can see how much concentration they've got going on. Just total focus on that boat.
Yeah, not only on the boat, but also out where the pressure is and, you know, where the opponents are. You need to take care of a lot of things when you're sailing these boats.
Having to look around, spot the wind, focus on the boat, sail the boat. It's all about technique. It's all about focus and concentration. And at the moment, Frank and Abbott are out in front at the bottom mark. They round first. Maloney and Meech trying to close the gap on them as we reach the halfway stage of this medal race in the 49er FX. The Rio silver medalists from New Zealand round the mark, but on trying to sneak in on the inside, Charlotte Dobson and Saskia Tidy. And the other Brits right behind them as well. The two Sophies were Gellin and Ainsworth, round in fourth. Now, the Dutch pairing of Van Aanholt and Jongens. But the other boat to keep an eye out on is Annemiek Beckering and Annette Duetsch of the Netherlands, who started the day in a bronze medal position, but they have dropped down to eighth. Now, if things remain as they are, they may just be able to sneak the bronze, but it'll depend on where other boats are. So we'll keep an eye on that battle for third, because right now it's between the Dutch pair and the Brazilians. And I was just looking to see where the Brazilians came round. They rounded in sixth. The Agroup sisters doing their best to recover from a penalty turn at the top mark, and almost completely stopped there as they try and power up again to head upwind for the final time.
Yeah, there's definitely some crazy conditions. We started off at 200th and we were down at 145, so that's a massive wind shift to the right, and that explains the change of course. And actually we are now back up to 180, so another 25 degree shift to the right this time. So it's very, very difficult for the teams to know which way to go. And at the moment, it looks like most of them are playing the left, because it was so far left, I think, in the first beat. But it might come back a little bit to the right, I think.
Yeah. Just so you know, the Norwegian crew, we saw they had that really slow tack. They are still, I've been watching them since we saw it, and they're still down at 2.5 knots. They've hardly got going. Everyone else is doing 4.
So really difficult conditions out on the water, Jenny.
It is extremely difficult conditions for these guys. It's frustrating to see where the puffs are, especially because some of the clouds are letting sunlight through and some are dark, and so that can confuse you as to whether it's a wind puff or a shadow from the clouds. At the moment, I think there's a little tiny pressure line on this right-hand side, and it looks like the two Netherland boats think that as well. So they've tacked off early, whether or not they had bad lanes on the far side or not, but they're continuing out to this right to then try to connect the dots further up towards the right-hand side.
That's how the fleet are laid out, but we're seeing all sorts of different colours and motion on the water.
Something is coming. And it's going to come from the right side.
Hard
and
from the right.
It's actually, I think it's, well, from here, from the look of our boxes, is fresh breeze coming in. Quite a lot of wind, actually.
A lot.
So we've got about 1.5 legs to go of this race. And the weather is changing all the time. Evie and Jordan predicting something big is coming, whatever that might be. But certainly the light... Oh, and we've got a capsize. And those are our leaders. Our leaders have gone over. Jenny, you're right beside them.
That is exactly what just happened. This huge right shift came through, and with it, pressure. And the Austrians got auto-tacked, and instead of being able to pull off, the auto-tack is when the wind makes you tack instead of you deciding to. It just capsized the Austrian boat. This is essentially disaster for them. That's the one thing that could take them out of gold medal position.
This is what happened.
This is what we call a massive right shift. Yeah. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see the Dutch teams, both of them, flying in front. Like, they were in a really bad position, and I'm pretty sure that's going to be our next shot.
Something big is coming in, said Evian Jordan. Something big did come in, and it hit our Austrian leaders, and they were in the water. And that means the Dutch have come through. Van Alten and Jongens, Beckering and Duetsch are now in contention, not just to win this medal race, but the second Dutch boat here is also in contention for snatching the gold medal away from the Austrians as they head upwind round the mark and then head downwind for the very final time. So from here, they've got one leg, and then it's a short dog leg, a short reach to the finish line. So the Austrians now, Frank and Abbott, for them to hold on to gold, need to start making their way up the fleet, and they're running out of time.
And it's straight to the bottom mark too.
It's crazy. It's a 60-degree wind shift to the right.
This is going to be fantastic. They'll be racing down. There's plenty of pressure in that gust.
The Brazilians in third, Grail and Kunze in fourth, Bad Nielsen and Olsen of Denmark. What we've seen as well, that wind shift has affected the other Danish pair of Hansen, Salskov, Iversen, who were challenging for the bronze medal. They're now down in eighth and out of contention for those medals. But anything could happen, even though there's so little time of the race to go. Our leaders, Van Aanholten and Jongens, out in front.
So that wind has moved so much they can't even put the spinnakers up.
Yeah, they are 90-degree shift now.
They are just... So they'll be beating upwind to the finish here. They'll go down to the bottom. Look at the pressure. So they should be carrying spinnakers. This is the downwind leg, and that's how much the wind has moved.
Wow. 17, 18 knots at the moment. This is one race.
And there in the top left corner of the screen, you can see the projected rankings, i.e. who's winning which medals. And at the moment, it's the Dutch, followed by the Austrians and then the Brits in third as they come to that bottom mark. The Dutch turn left, head towards the finish line. We're watching Aanholt and Jongens out in the lead, leading this medal race. And for the Dutch pair, it's victory. There's no medals for them, but there is a celebration. They have managed to catch the shifts to win the medal race. Now, here, finishing in second place, are the Dutch pair of Beckering and Duetsch. They wave as they cross the line ahead of Grail and Kunze, and that may well just be enough for Beckering and Duetsch to take the gold medal. Denmark's Bad Nielsen and Olsen cross in fourth, but all the way back now in ninth place, Frank and Abbott. Can they reel in just one position in order to snatch back gold? The Kiwis are across, so are the Brits of Wegelin and Ainsworth. We'll see the Dutch crossing the line in seventh, Hansen and Salskov Iversen, but who is behind them? Is it the Austrians? Or is it the Norwegians? And that will decide who gets the gold. It's the Norwegians. It's the twin sisters, the Agerup sisters, who crossed the line in eighth place. And by my calculations, that means Frank and Abbott will cross the line for silver, and gold has gone to the Dutch.
I do want to say there's two Dutch boats positioning themselves out to the right on that beat. They saw it coming.
Our overnight leaders crossed the line. They were dominant. They controlled the race. They were ahead. And then suddenly on that last leg, a huge puff dropped them into the water. a capsize that sent them to the back of the fleet, and they crossed the medal race finish line in last. So from first to last, Frank and Abbott have to make do with a silver medal. Hey, you know what? That's still pretty good at a world championship. And they give each other a hug and almost go for their second swim of the day.
Definitely going for their second swim. Hey, I love that sportsmanship, though. It's exactly right. Silver at a world championship, that is a rare honour.
That was a crazy race. And I think the Dutch did a really good move there. They were not in the best position at that second, at the downwind mark. And then, you know, they just went for it. And they saw it coming and... Yeah. Really good call.
You could see it coming too. It was just brutal.
Now, I don't want to put a dampener on it, but how much of that was luck for the Dutch?
They saw it.
When you're in the back of the fleet and you're still in the hunt for the medals, you need to do something. And that we could see it coming, so probably they could see something coming. And obviously, this was a really crazy race. Winds turning from left to right and pretty unpredictable. But that's sailing. And...
Those are our world champions, Beckering and Duetsch. And it's teamwork all the way from these two.
Depending on how you polish the boat, that can be very slippery.
But what a moment for this Dutch pair. What a race from them. They spotted the shift.
Well, you know, they said they were going to go for gold, and if they had the opportunity, they were going to take it, and that's exactly what they did.
Wow.
What a moment for the Dutch pair of Annemiek Beckering and Annette Duetsch. High five from them as they realise that they have just won gold at the World Championships. And celebrations in the water. They're in no hurry to go back. They're having a good time out there. They're enjoying themselves. So joy for the Dutch, but such disappointment for the Austrians. Look at this. They were in control, had been for most of the race. And then suddenly, the wind caught them. It was too strong. They lost control. In they went. Race over. Gold medal gone. Very little they could do with that.
Mm. Yeah, that was unfortunate. They were having such a great race. But they had an awesome weekend. I think they can look back to that, and a bit unfortunate, I would say, in this race, but still a silver medal, which is a great result.
Well, I was talking earlier in commentary about their consistency throughout, and the one time they were inconsistent cost them the gold medal, and that is the fine line that these sailors tread between glory and desolation.
It's the nature of the beast with offshore breeze as well. You can get exactly those things, and you know those things can happen. It would be very hard to take. These guys are just too happy to even right their boat at the moment. Look at the nervous excitement in the legs there.
Look at them. They've never won a world championship medal before, and they've decided today to make the first ever medal they win, a gold medal. Here in Aarhus.
Jenny, if she was, should have.
Let me just confirm the rankings. Beckering and Duetsch, then, gold medalists. The Austrians have to settle for silver, and Wegelin and Ainsworth of Great Britain get the bronze medal. And just out of the running, Grail and Kunze making their comeback here in the FX after timeout, finish in fourth place. That's what we were looking at over our studio earlier on. The dark clouds, the winds are coming in, and that means that all racing has been cancelled for the rest of the day. So we were hoping to bring you the kite boards, the foiling kites. That's not going to happen now. We're expecting thunder and lightning as well, so we've got a safety issue as well as these boats head off towards the dockside and their parade lap in front of the crowds. But let's look back at the race and see where it was won by the Dutch, where it was lost by the Austrians.
Well, it was all won on the second bait. We'll get to that, though. A little bit of a knock as the fleet came off in very light winds at this start line. Very light winds. The wind sort of went to the left. So we saw the fleet sort of tacking and hunting and hunting. And as we got to the top mark, there was a little bit of a bend to the left, a further bend to the left. And the group that were out there picked up a nice gain. So we saw our Austrian team that were leading overnight take the lead around the top mark. And this is a beautiful example of nice crew work as they go around with that tack. Chased hard, but slowly by the New Zealanders. In second, Maloney and Meach, and then Dobson and Tidy, the British team, were right there behind. So it was looking light, it was looking like a real challenge. They were looking for little pressure lines downwind as they went down. I think the Norwegians picked up a penalty for touching the mark here as well, and we're just seeing that, an evidence of that, and maybe even a little contact. But still, very light winds, hard to get it going, and we chase downwind and not a huge amount of change as we get down to this bottom mark. Still led by the Austrians, still in second for New Zealand, and still third for Dobson and Tidy from Great Britain. Most of the teams heading to this mark, we saw a change of course, everyone heading out to that side. And then we had a few of the teams starting to split right. We were actually talking about how slow these sailors were coming around this bottom mark, and they were getting stuck and doing very slow tacks. We had a nice little tight force there from the British team. Now what happened here was we had a few of the Austrians and another boat split out here to the right. Big pressure came. You could see it coming across the course, and it moved so much that they just basically went straight into that top mark. Unfortunately for our leaders, who are on the wrong tack because they are on the left-hand side of the course, they got knocked by as that new wind hit, and it capsized them. And they had an 11-point lead coming into this race. Almost impossible to lose, but that is the scenario that you need to lose it. The wind had moved so much now that the run was just a reach, a two-boat reach. These are quite difficult boats to sail on a two-boat. And the Danish team of Van Alt and Jongens were the first across the line, followed by Dekkering and Dutz, and that was enough in second place to push them up to the top mark. Also, Grahl and Kunz were over that side, and they managed to get across the line in third. Our friends from Austria, they finished last across the line, but Frank and Avicht ended up coming second overall. And the British team of Wigelin and Ainsworth, who I think would be pretty happy, managed to get a third at the World Championships. It was a very exciting race. And fantastic to watch these boats sail.
Two absorbing races in the 49er and the 49er FX. Two completely different races. And in fact, the second race with the FX had about four different seasons all in every leg was a different season, wasn't it, really? Wow.
Definitely. Winter was coming. Crazy. But what a race. So exciting.
Disappointment for the Danes. They had high hopes of a medal here. But it wasn't to be. Finishing in fifth place in the end, behind the Brazilians of Grahl and Kunze, who were fourth.
You can see how much fun these boats are to sail, just the way they move around.